We thank you, Lord, for this day once again. Thank you for this evening as we gather together. We say, come, Holy Spirit, and be our teacher. In Jesus' name, Amen. There are different levels of following, because it's not just following the initial following of Jesus, but a continual walk with him. And so there may be people here who need to start following Jesus, and there may be people here who have been following him all their lives, and there's still something that they need to step out and do, or another track that Jesus wants to take you on. Okay? So we're looking at Mark 1, 15 to 18, and Jesus says, "The time has come," Jesus said, "the kingdom of God is near. Repent and believe the good news." As Jesus walked beside the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting a net into the lake. "Come, follow me," Jesus said, "and I will make you fishers of men." At once they left their nets and followed him. And then Matthew 9, 9 to 13. As Jesus went on from there, he saw a man named Matthew sitting at the tax collector's booth. "Follow me," he told him, and Matthew got up and followed him. While Jesus was having dinner at Matthew's house, many tax collectors and sinners came and ate with him and his disciples. When the Pharisees saw this, they asked his disciples, "Why does your teacher eat with tax collectors and sinners?" On hearing this, Jesus said, "It is not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. But go and learn what this means. I desire mercy, not sacrifice. For I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners." So this first session, the first following Jesus session, I'm calling invitation. Yeah? And what is the invitation of Jesus? What is the call of Jesus? It's quite simply, come, follow me. Yeah, that's what he says. Later on he says, follow me, to Matthew. So come, follow me is the full formulation, shall we say. This is his invitation. It's so simple. And I just briefly want to look at those three words. Yeah? So come. In the Greek, the come would have an exclamation mark. It's an imperative word. Okay, there's a sense of urgency about it. Come. And that's what he's saying to them. That's what he's saying to us. And it struck me that we've made such a big deal about inviting Jesus in. In our believing and evangelical circles, it's become so much about inviting Jesus in. No, he does the inviting, not you and me. You know, we've just turned it all upside down in our head, somehow or the other, because we have this sense of our lives, our independence, our this, our that. But before we go to him, he came to us, no? Yeah, God became man, the Word became flesh, all of that. First, Jesus came, and then he said, come. So the invitation is from him. It's his initiative. It's his choice. Okay. And I think this is so important for us who have been in the Lord for such a long time and we've done so much for Jesus that somehow we forget the simple fact that it was his initiative and his choice and his invitation that we responded to. Not him responding to our invitation, but us responding to him. And then we'll unpack that a little more, hopefully, as we go on. Okay. So what is this invitation? What is this choice? He calls us. He invites us. The invitation is to come, which has a sense of movement. When we're told to come, we've got to move out from where we are somewhere else. Okay. We cannot stay where we are. Again, before he asks us to move, he first moved. In fact, he moved from heaven to earth. Okay? We'll see later on, no? Everything that Jesus asks us to do, he's done first. There's nothing he asks us to do that he hasn't done first. Okay? So he moved, and now he calls us to move when he says, come. There has to be movement. There has to be movement in our lives if we are responding to Jesus. And I'm not just talking about the initial response, but any response to Jesus has to involve movement. Otherwise, it doesn't make any sense. You can't be sitting where we are and say, oh, I'm so happy something with Jesus happened. There has to be movement, whether it's in our spirits or physically in our lives. And of course, when he calls us to come, when he's asking us to move, it's always to a better place. We have that confidence. Okay? So let's take Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd. Okay? Where does he call us to? Green pastures and still waters. He calls us to a better place. Let's take the famous one of Jesus in Matthew chapter 10, must be 11, I suppose. come to me all who are weary. 10 or 11, one of them. Matthew 10, okay. Yeah. Come to me all. He says, come to me all who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Again, he's calling us to a better place. Even when he talks about his yoke, he says his yoke is easy, my burden is light. Okay? So we have that confidence. When he's calling us to come, he's calling us to move, and it is to a better place. Often we don't see that. That's a sad thing on our parts, that we don't realize that or see that or trust that. But he's always calling us into a better place. So that's the first word, come. And the second word is follow. Now when Jesus, you know, when we look at that scene, it's so bizarre. He's just walking by, and yeah, they've met him once before at least. We know that, if not more times. He says, come, follow me, and they leave everything and follow him. One of the versions says that they left their father also. No? Later on, I think James and John left their father with the hired hands and followed him. But for them, there was a clear, shall we say, paradigm. This was a rabbi calling disciples. A rabbi choosing disciples. We have an example in the Old Testament, Elijah going and throwing his cloak on Elisha's back. And Elisha knows that in that act, Elijah is calling him to be his disciple. And he leaves his family and sets off and follows Elijah. So they have that pattern, and we see them doing that. And it's the same thing with us. It is a leader, it's a teacher, it's a Lord, our Savior, whatever, calling us. Okay? Again, we go back to that thing of, did we invite him or were we invited? Okay? So if the rabbi choosing his disciples, are we qualified to be his disciples? Were the fishermen qualified? By then, they had already somehow realized he was, like, you know, in one case they say that we found the Messiah. Now, we know that the understanding was a little shaky compared to what we know now. But obviously, they knew that he was somebody amazing, somebody, a major teacher. And I'm sure, therefore, when they jumped up to follow him, it could not have been with any sense of, you know, we're qualified, we can do this. It was quite the opposite. 3.5 years later, when Peter and John are being questioned by the Pharisees, what do the Pharisees say about them, the high priest and all of that? Ordinary, uneducated people. See, that was what they were. They were not qualified. And neither are we. And so we come again to this thing of we inviting Jesus. It's as if we're doing him a favor. You know, I'm really struck by, you know, as I looked at this, I'm struck by the language that we use. It's almost like I'm doing Jesus a favor by inviting him into my life and saying, be Lord of my life and I will work for you. No, it's a privilege. We're not qualified. We're nobody. Why should he even bother to choose us? Yeah? And I think it's so much more important to people like me, for example, who have spent so many years serving the Lord, we can really get into this think of, oh, God owes me so much. Because I've done so much for him, I've sacrificed so much for him. It was all a privilege. It should have all been a privilege. You know, that's the only thing that makes sense, that allows us to make sense of the parable of the talents, not talents, parable of the workers in the vineyard. When the person who worked 11 hours, you can just imagine, we've been out in the heat for a little time and look how drained we are. The person who works 11 hours gets the same as the person who works 1 hour. How can that be fair? It can only make sense if the privilege was working. It doesn't make any sense otherwise. And we get that privilege. We get that privilege of working, and somehow we've turned it around and as if we've done God a favor. By following him, by working for him, by doing things for him, by sacrificing for him, when all of it was a privilege. He initiated something. He chose the unqualified. He called us. He gave us amazing things to do. And I know for me, when I look back, the thing about Jesus, I said, what attracted you? What made me decide to follow him simply was that he gave purpose to my life. I can't imagine living without that purpose, that there's something higher that I'm doing. Otherwise, why do we waste our time? Why live at all? You know? Or eat, drink, and be merry. That also makes sense, actually. But Jesus comes and he gives such meaning and purpose to our lives. Okay? So he says, follow, though they were not qualified, though we are not qualified, we follow. And therefore, it's not just a call to move, But if it's a call to follow, it's in a certain direction. There's a clear direction to where he's calling us to follow. And in this case, it happens to be towards him or after him. And so if you look at those words, you know, Jesus didn't say, come accept me, come serve me, come worship me, come receive me, come love me. He said, come follow me. And if you look at Mark, what we just read, there are two other words that he tells us to do. There is repent and believe. Okay? These are not the words with which we call people to Jesus. We call people to Jesus for healing, for deliverance, for blessing, because he loves you. All of those kind of things, no? And yet Jesus is, the words that we're seeing here in Mark 1 are follow, repent, believe. And all of those three words involve a change of direction. Follow, because you might be going anywhere, now follow. Yeah? Repent. What does repent mean? Said many times. Turn around. Take a 180 degree turn. Change your mind. Metanoia. Change your mind. It requires a change. And believe. If he's asking us to believe in X, that means before that we believed in Y. Yeah? So follow, repent, believe. All of them involve not just movement, change. A change of direction. So that's the second word in the invitation, follow. And the third word in the invitation is the best word of all, me. The Greek is actually come hither, come here to me. It's all about Jesus. And as I studied this and read this, I said, yes, this is it. It's about him. He's calling us to him. And that's what makes it so amazing. You know, you think of any other, we were the other day discussing, I think yesterday, we were discussing Rajneesh and Osho and Buddha and all of that with Aman, who is probably our resident expert, because he's done all those things. You know, he's gone through all those things. And we were discussing, and it was just striking me that what do all these other people get invited into? You know? Into the Eightfold Path, for example. Let's say, Eightfold Path of nobleness or whatever it's called, to salvation or whatever. You know, doing eight types of things or whatever. We get invited into all that. Jesus invites us to himself. He says, come, follow me. And now that song makes so much sense. No, I have decided to follow Jesus. Not I have decided to join the Anglican Church. You understand? But that's what we've gone and made Christianity about. I've decided to join this group. I've decided to join that group. I've decided to whatever. I have decided to follow Jesus because that's what he called us to. He didn't call us to church. Church comes afterwards and it's all of that. But he called us to follow him. Our commitment is to a person, not to a church, not even to a religion. You know, the believers were first called Christians. Why? Christian means little Christ. They were called Christians because of who they followed, not because of what they followed. Today we are called Anglicans and Baptists and Catholics and we are still trying to figure out what to call highwaymen, highway people, what highwayers. Okay? We are not called to all that, no? We end up becoming all that. Okay? We should be recognized by who we follow, not by what we follow. And we've ended up becoming recognized by what we follow. Okay? And so I realized that when Jesus says, come follow me, it's an invitation into freedom. Yeah? And you talk of these two kinds of freedom. There's negative freedom, freedom from something. There's positive freedom, freedom to do something. Yeah? And so the negative freedom, which is very important, is freedom from law, from religion, rituals, traditions, all these things that we end up following. And even religious leaders tell us that that's the way. If you're a Christian, you've got to do X, Y, Z. And all that X, Y, Z has to do somehow with works and not with Jesus. We get freedom from law, duties, all that. We also get the freedom to relate. When he says, come, follow me, he invites us into relationship. I realized for the last 20 years, almost everything I teach comes back to relationship. He invites us into relationship. Okay? Relationship with God. And then we also have relationship with his people, but also a relationship with the world that is the way God wanted it to be, wants us to be. Okay? We get freedom to relate in all those ways. We get freedom from having to somehow just, conform. Just conform to a list of do's and don'ts, which can go from what to do and what to, how to, what to wear and all of that. We get free from those things. Because the invitation is really so simple. It is so basic. It is come, follow me. Now he might be saying it to someone here today in the most basic sense of what he told Simon Peter. Come follow me, Simon and Andrew. Which is, your life is going this way, come follow me. You know, I'm constantly struggling in terms of how to word an altar call. Because all our altar calls are this, inviting Jesus into our lives. And I've just said that's the opposite of what he's telling us. You know, I'm constantly struggling. I don't know, the words don't come out. The words just don't come out because as I read the Bible, it's so different what Jesus did and how he invited. And so even now, I feel that the invitation is to follow him. And you will know if you're following him or not. So my altar call today, and I'm going to give one each time, is simply tell Jesus, I want to follow you. Yeah, I will follow you. Yeah, but it's also for those of us who have spent donkey's years in the faith. Yeah, we did the altar calls. How many people here have gone in front to give your life to Jesus more than once? You've done it, no? You know what I mean. You've done it time and time again. Sometimes I feel we should get baptized also every now and then. You know, not more than once. You know, because you just feel what happened after that baptism. Yeah? You might be in that place and you may feel that God may be calling me to follow him somewhere else. And maybe I need to take that step. Yeah? So that's all I want to say today. I'm just going to keep a moment of silence, and in your mind, if you want to tell Jesus, I want to follow you, because that's it. I think Jesus is telling each one of us, whether it's for the first time or whether it is after 40 years of following him, he's saying, come, follow me. He's asking us to move. He's asking us to change direction. And he's asking us to, that the direction we take is towards him or after him. Okay? That relationship. Okay? So let's just spend a moment in silence. And if you want to say, Jesus, I want to follow you. Jesus, I will follow you. In your minds, say it, and I'll say a closing prayer. And when Simon and Andrew left their boats and followed Jesus, they really didn't know what they were in for. They had almost no knowledge. They were completely unqualified and really completely ignorant of what lay ahead of them. They just followed Jesus because they were attracted to him. And I want to thank you, Lord, for each one today, Lord, who has said, each one of us, Lord, have said that we will follow you, whether for the first time or after years of knowing you, and even years of following you. And I invite you to come, Holy Spirit, and seal that decision, and seal that commitment. Whether tonight or over these 2 days, 3 days, Lord, give us understanding of where You're taking us. Even if just that next step, Lord. And give us the grace to obey. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.